Hey, welcome back. This is part two of our chat with John Rowlands. You know, I Googled the name John Rowlands a few days ago, and a whole bunch of things popped up, of course, as Google will do. But the one thing that struck me the most was the headline that said, John Rowlands, the iconic photographer. If you reach the stage where people are calling you iconic, then there's no place you can be but right here with me in the NYthespirit.com video channel. Sorry, John, I couldn't resist. How did you get involved with David Bowie?
Well, living in Palm Springs in 2011, I got an email from Eileen, who was his manager in New York. And I'd done a lot of work on Diamond Dogs, Station to Station, and Isolar 2, the Berlin tour. And she said, do you still have the negatives to that shot of David that you made a poster from in 86? I said, sure do. So. And then she told me we'd switched to phone by this point, and told me about what was coming up. David Bowie is 2013 at the V&A Museum in London. And they wanted to use that as the press relations shot to establish the show. I said, whatever you need, it's here for you.
And which shot was this?
That was the Archer.
Yes, that's a very famous picture.
It's one of David's favorites, my all-time favorite shot of concert photography.
You had it hanging on your wall before it became famous.
Yeah, I made a poster of it, sold it throughout the United States, did well with that.
Yes.
And then limited edition prints to a small extent, and then it got much larger with the V&A.
Now, did you tour with David?
Three tours, Diamond Dogs, Station to Station, with Tracy Hayden on guitar, Toronto kid, and Isolar 2, which was the 78.
Tell me about that. What was it like on touring with David?
Well, the nice thing in the beginning was, in order to compliment somebody I enjoyed working with, I put a dark room in my hotel room.
Seriously?
Seriously. And after the show, with a Hasselblad, you had 12 shots per film. I was getting a new special film from Ilford that had 24 shots on it, which would give me about 5 feet of negatives. I'd get back to the hotel room. I'd set up my enlarger and tanks in the bathroom, tank the film.
And you were hauling all this gear with you?
Yeah, in a small compact.
I hope you had a roadie.
Very large suitcase. I just went along with the team. Yeah. And process the film, hang it up to dry, no machines to dry it, so I'd go to sleep for 4 hours. And then cut the film, make contact sheets on my little Durst 606, was a footprint about yay big. And around 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock in the morning, go across the hall to the same caliber of room, and that was David's place, and we'd have breakfast and look at contact sheets.
Really?
And after a few days of doing that, we continued to have breakfast, but he said, don't bring the contact sheets anymore.
Oh, that's interesting.
He said, I like the way you look, see things, and capture them. I trust you with everything we'll do. And on average from each show, find 6 shots that we can send to RCA and tell them that it's my choice.
Was David different offstage than on?
Well, a little bit in the beginning, there was a big difference because he was the characters. Certainly, right. As time went along, he became much more comfortable with his audiences and with the people that worked for him.
So when he had Ziggy, he lived in that character?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah. The Mick Ronson, Ziggy Stardust, and band became the identity. And then Diamond Dogs, another identity. And the Iggy years, another identity, and the Peter Frampton years, another identity, and so on, so on, so on. But then when it got to be Gail and Sterling and Slick in the New York days, then it became casual, and there were 2 or 3 variations on that band. I called him when Tin Machine came out and said, you know, I'd really like to do some shots of Tin Machine. John, it's just a band. don't bother.
Really?
And that was enough to say, okay, you don't want it, you don't need it, you don't think it's worthy, that's okay. He said there's no dynamic to four or five guys. Where the single characters, what I concentrated on, he loved it. And when I gave him the proof sheet with the Archer on it, he said, oh good, you got the Archer. He already knew the name of it because it was fashioned after his interest and curiosity in the Spanish Civil War.
What in the world, whose idea was it to have him do?
David's.
That was David's idea.
And I saw it happen at the Montreal show the night before Toronto, and I made sure I was in a position down front about 30 feet away with that telephoto lens again to get it the way I wanted it.
So the photo that we know as the Archer seems to be a posed, photo. Are you suggesting there's two Archers?
There's two Archers because, number one, I asked him years later, I said, why did you do that then? He said, well, it was a lighting cue to my lighting director that when the fingers are released and go up, go to black. And that's exactly what happened.
Wow.
I got a shot with the fingers down, fingers up. Third shot I still have was black.
Wow.
So that's the 1, 2, 3 of it all. But where that pose came from was kind of in memory of the Spanish Civil War. There are two Archer statues overlooking the sea in Spain, at Alicante, Spain.
I did not know that.
And they're made of metal, and they're in the Archer pose. And that's the reason he got his body in that shape.
Wow, that's really interesting.
The lighting with that scoop of hair in front, and the delicacy for the shirt and whatnot, was all David's lighting. He did every aspect of the show. Lighting, sound, special effects. Saw his sound and vision tour in 93 or 2 in Niagara Falls. And he was much more than just a guy doing shows and you know, do an hour and a half and get the hell out of town, you know. He was the persona in each character and tailor-made for every kid in the audience.
I think that comes through.
Yeah, yeah.
It's said, and I think you might be able to tell us about this, when he is the character, the on switch is up. When he's out of the character, the on switch comes down and he is David Bowie.
Regular guy, buddy, high school pal, college buddy.
I think you were saying earlier as we drove here that he would take his kids to school.
Yeah, his daughter.
His daughter.
He'd walk to school with her. He didn't like having to do the camouflage like Michael Jackson did. Didn't like khaki pants and a baseball cap, but he had to get his girl to school or the library after school. And he would put up with that crap. After a while, they started citing him and he changed the disguise or not walk her as often.
I think the last photograph that was taken to him was an on-street photograph taken obviously by a fan. Mm-hmm. And he was wearing a suit or disguise. He was wearing some kind of a hat. I don't know what they're called, those hats. And a windbreaker and khaki pants.
Mm-hmm.
And someone would really have to know it was him to have spotted him.
Yeah.
There's another photographer who is also considered iconic. His name is Eric
Schwab.
Schwab, that's it. There's a connection somewhere between Eric Schwab and David Bowie.
Eric Schwab is the father to David's 35-year tenure with Coco Schwab, his daughter.
Wow.
And
so Coco Schwab was with David for 35 years.
Yes, personal assistant, yeah.
And her father was the famous photographer.
Yes, sir. His claim to fame was he got into syndication of his work from World War II. He was one of the, as you use the word, iconic and scarily so, kind of the official and it's a corny word to use, but one of the better photographers of Auschwitz and the atrocities of the Holocaust. And I can't talk about it without tearing up.
No, I understand.
Or getting goosebumps. But in any case, in the late 70s, I was syndicating my work around the world and didn't have a distributor for Europe, and was looking at, of all syndications that were there, writers and Reuters or whatever, and another agency called Black Star, and that was Eric.
Black Star was an agency?
Syndication, yeah.
Tell me a bit about that.
The name of the game is, if you've got an iconic or a newsworthy shot, you send a master print to the syndicator, and they make sure that everybody with interest in it gets to buy it through them, put it on their magazine covers or in the newspaper if it's newsworthy.
And it was called Black Star.
Black Star, yes, sir.
Now let me think, where did that game appear again?
Somewhere in the recording world. And this is the comparison to it all. And Coco and David knew that. And many, many stories evolve around that. And some of the instigation that would involve shots that were taken that were syndicated by Black Star would be promoted and made available in stories and whatnot, because David and Coco would construct the deal. And thus...
Do you think that's why the album and the song Black Star exists?
I think it was a connection to make Black Star work the way it worked.
Does Black Star still exist?
I don't think so. I don't think so. As recent as certainly the end of the 70s it was there, but I don't know afterwards.
We could go on about Kiss. We could go on about Michael Jackson. We could go on about Clapton. We could go on about Windsor Castle, where you've also done work.
Yeah.
We could go on and on and on, John. But gosh, what stories you tell.
Well, and this show will go on and on and on in our stead.
Well, don't go away. Keep doing it.
Thank you.
I know you still shoot. Actually, I had never seen your face until today, because usually there's a camera in front of it.
Yeah, and there will be later this afternoon.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, David. Pleasure.
It's a pleasure.
Always.
Well, what a chat, eh? Thanks for watching.
Avenue, we were lovers of St. Avenue. Avenue, Avenue.